Well, we are so glad that you're here as we begin week 3 of our relationship series. If you guys have been with us, you know that kind of our driving force, our driving factor has been this idea that dating is for companionship, but I am made for completion. Gene, I'm so glad you made it. Gene was just singing in the choir, which came down to be with us today. Thanks so much, Gene.
Thank you.
And we know you're going to date. We know you're going to date, and we want to help you have an awesome time dating. We want to help you be creative and enjoy dating, because I think that's what God made it, you know, for relationships. So the first part is knowing that dating is for companionship. I am made for completion. If you are dating someone because you think they're going to make you happy or they're going to fix your life or make everything perfect, that is the wrong way to date. The only way, the only person that was made to complete you was God. That's how you were created, to have a relationship with Him. And He's the only one that will complete you. So anything else is going to leave you short of that. So last week, Zach Wise spoke to us about what it means to be a man after God's own heart and how to be a great guy. The idea there is that instead of looking for the perfect person who's going to make your life so awesome and everything, instead of looking for the perfect person, we want you to focus on being the perfect person. If you be the kind of guy that you are the girls are going to want to be, you're not going to ever have a problem finding a relationship. And today's focus is the same way for you girls, that instead of looking for the perfect person, you just try to be the one. So looking for the one, you just be the one. I hope that makes sense. And so today, last week we talked about guys. This week we're talking about girls. So I thought we'd bring a professional girl down to the stage. So, man, Jean, you survived middle school.
I did.
You survived high school. You have 2 daughters of your own.
Yes.
They survived middle school.
They did.
And now you have granddaughters.
Yes.
2 of them have survived.
Yeah, I have 1 in middle school and 2 in high school.
Yeah, so.
And 1 in kindergarten.
If anyone knows what it means to be a woman, I'm thinking you do, Jean.
I've been one for a long time.
And all your life.
Yeah.
That's helpful. So I went to your Facebook and stole some pictures. Here is you and your 12-year-old husband. That is Terry. He looks so young. Is that mustache real?
It's real, yeah. The Navy allowed that.
The Navy allowed. Yeah. He looks so young and cute.
He was 22, though. Right?
22, and you were?
20.
20. Robin the Cradle. Telling you.
He liked younger women.
Yeah, jeez. Wow. You guys were married for how long?
45 years.
45 years. Here's what Terry looks like. This Terry, your sweet husband, who passed away just a couple months ago. So sad. We miss Terry.
Yeah.
Such an awesome guy. Here's another picture of you and Terry and your girls here. How long ago was this picture taken?
Oh, my word. It was in the early 90s, so that's a day or 2 ago.
Yeah.
You can tell by the weird hair and clothes.
And his mustache has really filled in nicely.
Right.
I am jealous. He's, looks very manly, Terry.
Yeah.
All right, and here are your girls. You took this last year. So who are these girls? What are their names?
Let's see. The one on your right is my daughter, Lisa. She's Pastor Todd's wife. And then the one on your left is my youngest daughter, Chrissy, and she is a nurse, and she lives in Columbus. And she has 5 kids.
Wow.
So, yeah.
That's a lot of kids.
So, yeah, I have a lot of grandkids.
I worry about people with 5 children. That's me.
I think you know one.
Yeah, that's so crazy. Wow. So, all right. So you have survived middle school, survived high school. Certainly there was a time in your middle school life when you had a crush on someone, this person who was going to complete you.
Oh, yeah. Although it's so long ago, it was called junior high.
Junior high, not middle school.
Junior high, not middle school. It was junior high. And you didn't go there until you were in 7th grade. So my first crush in 7th grade. Whew.
What was his name?
His name was Tom Kennedy.
Tom Kennedy.
Like
John F.
Yes. Although I don't know that they were related, but he was dreamy. He was really cute. But I was so shy, I couldn't talk to him. I was just too afraid to talk to him. But somehow I just thought, I really would like to be his girlfriend. So we rode the same school bus. So one day, In the afternoon on the way home, the seat in front of him was empty. So I slid in there, and I thought, maybe I get the courage to say something? No. Maybe if I turn around and smile at him, he will smile back, and maybe he'll say something, and then I'll get the courage to talk to him.
Your eyes will connect. Yes. You'll be love at first sight. You'll seduce him. You are a seducer.
So I turned around and smiled at him, but he glared back. He glared back with a real angry look.
What?
And he shouted out, "You turn those big bug eyes around and quit staring at me." Oh, I was crushed.
Oh my God.
My crush had crushed him. He wasn't my crush anymore.
He crushed you.
He crushed me. Everybody on the bus heard him, and I just wanted to kind of become invisible.
So
I was, it was terrible. But you can see I survived all that.
Yeah, you did. You survived it.
I survived it. So, but why is that important? Why is it important that this crush crushed me? Because like Ken was saying, we are created to have relationships. And us girls are always, from the time we're little, thinking about our wedding. Were any of you girls ever a flower girl in someone's wedding? Yeah. I was the flower girl for my aunt when I was 4 years old. So I was dreaming about a wedding for a long, long time before I ever had a wedding. And I didn't even know when I dreamed about my wedding, the groom was kind of faceless because I didn't know who I was going to marry. I just knew I was going to have a wedding and get married someday. So we are created for relationships, but what we are not created for, we are not created to have our value and our worth decided by someone else. That's taking away from us as a person. So we don't want that to happen. We are not created to give our value and worth to another person. And it kind of happens subtly. And a very like generic example of how that happens between girls and guys, is when, this is a study that was done. When girls and boys are in elementary school, they score about the same in math.
They're about the same across the board.
And then as they get older, get into middle school, get into high school, quite often the girls' scores start dropping.
And why is that?
Because psychologists believe that girls just don't want to be smarter than the guys because that's not cool. The guys won't like them if they're smarter than them.
Like guys are intimidated by them.
Our culture has kind of set us up for that. I think it might be getting a little better now, but you know, that's kind of been the status quo.
But the idea that girls would pretend to not be as smart or not do as well.
So that they could be cool enough for the guys to like them.
And you know, and that's not, and it gets a lot darker from there, Gene. You know, girls and guys, as guys we do this too, that we often will change ourselves or what we believe in order to get into a relationship. You know, no one would ever imagine when they have their cell phone taking a picture, an inappropriate picture, and sending it to someone they don't know, but that happens. It happens.
It does.
All the time, unfortunately. And it just breaks my heart because so many of our students are willing to do whatever it takes to get into a relationship. And then once they're in a relationship, they'll do almost even more to stay in a relationship. So even like sometimes for girls, a guy will threaten, "Hey, I'm gonna break up with you unless you do this or unless you send this to me." And they'll be like, "Okay, well, I don't want to lose this relationship because we're in love, so I guess it's not, you're the only one who'll see it," then they'll send it to them. And it just gets progressively worse. And that can happen physical boundaries as well. Oh, man, it just, that's not how we were created. Yeah. Absolutely. So difficult. So why do we do that? That's what we want you to jump into your small groups to talk about. Girls, why would a girl change herself and or do things she normally wouldn't just to get a guy to like them? And guys,
Guys, why do we do the same thing? Why do we change who we are just to get girls to like us, all right? We're going to give you 5 minutes for your small group to talk about that. Why do we change ourselves to get someone to like us, all right?
All right. Well, we're glad to be back up here. You know, this whole idea of changing yourself is a difficult one, especially for me as a dad. I have 3 daughters of my own that I love, and when I think about them changing themselves in order to get a guy to like them or in order to stay in a relationship, you know, it breaks my heart. I never want my girls, like if some guy does something inappropriate to them or says something inappropriate to them, I don't want them to tolerate that, because to me, they are priceless. To me, they are so precious that if someone does something to them, I don't want them to think that's normal. I don't want them to be like, I guess that's okay. Like, no way. That is not who you are. And yet so many of our kids are willing to trade and change themselves in order to get to a relationship or to stay in a relationship.
So, yeah, because when we change ourselves in order to get someone to like us, it sets us up for disappointment. It sets us up for self-destruction. Because God never intended that guys would give girls their worth, or that girls would give guys their worth. God had something much, much bigger in store. So when we let someone else give us our worth, it puts that person in a position they were never, never intended to be in. They weren't created to be like that. And I think probably some of you are sitting up there saying, oh, no, I don't do that. I don't think like that. I wouldn't do that. But I think it happens in ways that are so subtle we don't even realize that it's happening to us.
Mm, yeah,
and it's hard. And it keeps us from knowing how awesome we are, how awesome God wants us to be, and how awesome He created us to be.
Yeah. So, and how precious.
Yes.
What's like one of the most precious things to you? What's the one of the most valuable things that you guys have? What would you guys say? Just shout it out. What?
Something tangible that you'd go and buy.
My clarinet.
Your clarinet? That would be huge.
That's
right?
Expensive. Totally. Hugely expensive.
My phone.
Shoes, video games.
Somebody said a phone.
I keep hearing it. Phone. Cell phone. I know for a lot of middle schoolers, that cell phone, you know, that's what they all want. You gotta have that thing.
Yes.
Especially the iPhone, right? You gotta have your iPhone.
Yes. So, just pretend for a few minutes this morning that this cell phone represents how valuable you are. Even though you are so much more, we can't put a price on it. You are so much more valuable than a cell phone. But just for a few minutes, bear with me. This represents you.
Okay? So that cell phone is us.
This is us. Yeah. I think that's a new TV show, although I haven't watched it. This is us. Yeah. So, this is you. This is you. And
especially for girls.
Especially for girls. This is going to be an example of what it's like when you give your identity and your value and worth to someone else for them to decide, you know, who you are. And so it's maybe a little generic, but I think you'll get the picture. So, okay, girls, you've met Prince Charming, and you've been going together for a whole week. You are in love. You are just up there in the clouds. And then he breaks up with you. And you can't sleep. And you can't sleep. And you don't want to go to school. And you don't want to put down your friends. And pretty soon your brain is thinking, I'm not wanted. Well then, maybe you've got this special guy friend. But if the truth be told, he is more than a friend to you, and you just really, really like him. But he won't commit. And he won't talk to you in public, and he won't acknowledge you in front of his friends. But he'll Snapchat you after school. He'll text you at night. And after a while, you think, I am just not special enough. Or you're sitting home alone, and you're watching TV. And then you're thinking, my friends are out with their boyfriends at the movies. They're at their boyfriend's house having dinner. The boyfriend comes over and watches movies with them. I am alone. Everybody's better than me. So,
well, there goes that phone.
Yeah. After a while, we sort of crack up, don't we? We just crack under the pressure. Because that is forcing us to want to become someone different. We want to become someone that other person is going to like. And so we're asking that person to define who we are.
And when we do that, it breaks us.
It breaks us.
We have this precious thing, and when we let someone else tell us what makes us good, then it hurts so bad.
It does. But God tells us there is a different way. He has a much better plan for your life and for you. And he loves you. So I just wonder what it would look like if we started to really believe what God says about us and not get caught up in what some guy or girl is wanting us to be.
Yeah, so let's look at God's word. What does God say about us? This is written from the book of Isaiah. This is what God wrote and said through Isaiah. Isaiah said it to his people, to the chosen people. He said, don't be afraid. I called your name. You're mine. When you're in over your head, I'll be there with you. When you're in rough waters, you'll not go down. When you're between a rock and a hard place, it won't be a dead end. Because I am God, your personal God, the Holy of Israel, your Savior. I paid a huge price for you and Gene, for us. Even though this was written in the Old Testament before Jesus was born, we live in a time that now that Jesus, we know that it really was a huge price, that God sent his own Son, Jesus, for us. And I love that part. That's how much you mean to me. That's how much I love you. I'd sell off the whole world to get you back, trade the creation just for you. That is so powerful.
It is, Steve. That's how much God loves you. That's how much God thinks of you. And he gave you the individuality to be your own person.
Yeah, huge. And so if you don't leave here with anything, we want you to leave here with this. You are a priceless creation. You are a priceless creation beyond value. That's why an iPhone is so pathetic in representing us, because you guys are worth so much more than that. And I think if we will take God at his word, if we will really believe in our deepest part of us that we are a priceless creation, God has another plan. I mean, he wants to wrap you up in his protection. He wants to take care of you and protect you from these hard times, I think. Absolutely.
How many of you, maybe two, three of you, would loan me your cell phone?
All right, we need to come to you guys to let Gene borrow your phone.
I don't have one.
I won't use the hammer.
You're not
right
going to destroy them?
Just bring it down. Bring it down.
If you'll trust Gene with your phone. We've seen what she can do. There we go. Let's just do these two or
great.
Three. That's probably more than that.
You
can't
do
more than that. I'm so sorry. Everyone's willing to get their phone broken today.
Great. Awesome.
All right. So, Gene, you're going to wrap up these phones. Oh, we only do these three. So sorry. Thank you for being willing to trust Gene, the crazy lady, with your phone. Are these ones too big? These are like phablets. Look at that iPhone. That thing is huge. Here, let me make it smaller. Will they all fit in your mouth?
They're
Just squeeze them in. Yeah, nice. So we got our safe here. Oh, we got to lock it up. Nice job. So this kind of represents God, God's protection for you. So now what happens when those hard times come, Jean?
Well, you know, God's true. God says, I want you to know the truth. And I want you to have that truth so deep, deep, deep down in your heart that when he breaks up with you, you won't be broken. When he doesn't miss you, you won't be broken. When he doesn't choose you, you won't be broken, because God made you. God made you. He loves you. And you are chosen, you are loved, you are wanted, and most important of all, you are a priceless, an absolute priceless creation.
Yeah, that's huge. So we want you to meet in your small groups, and let's talk about, oh, are there supposed to be pieces? Totally kidding. Let's talk about, what does that mean? What does it mean to be, for something to be priceless, all right? So jump into your small groups. We'll give you a few minutes, 5 minutes to talk about, what does that mean for something to be priceless, all right? Go for it. All right. Well, this idea, we hope you really get, that idea that you are a priceless creation. You know, we know you guys are going to date, and we love dating. So, love dating our spouses. So we know you're going to do it. We want to help you do it. But when you date for someone to complete you, you're going to end up sad. You're going to end up broken like that. The only person that was made to complete you is God. And so when you let other people form your identity, that can be really, really hard. But if you will get this idea that you are a priceless creation, you are of so value, that will change how you respond to guys and girls.
Yeah. If you can do that, if you can believe God, believe what he says about you, then when the guy doesn't choose you, you're not broken. When the guy doesn't notice you, you're not broken, or girl. When the guy doesn't keep going out with you, when he breaks up with you, you're not broken. Because you know deep in your heart, beyond a shadow of a doubt, that you are God's priceless creation. You're very important, you're very valuable, you're unique, you're individuals, and you're very loved.
Yeah, so important. We want you guys to really leave here knowing how precious you are, and knowing that if you could get that to the deepest part of you, it would change everything for you. There's a great song by For King and Country called Priceless that we like you to really pay special attention to, especially the lyrics. So we're going to leave you with this. So check out this video.
Mirror, mirror, mirror on the wall, telling those lies, pointing out your flaws. That isn't who you are. That isn't who you are. It might be hard to hear, but let me tell you, dear, if you could see what I could see, I know you would believe that isn't who you are. There's more to who you are.
If you would like to see what a broken iPhone really looks like, you can come on up here. There is real glass here, though, so please be very, very careful. The last thing we want is you going home bleeding, right? So let me pray for us, and then we will let you guys go. God, thank you for this morning. Thank you for loving us so much that you would send your son, Jesus, to die on the cross for us. God, even while we were still sinners, even in our selfishness, you loved us, and you still love us. Thank you. You're amazing. We love you. Amen. Hey, you guys have a great week. Sign up for VIX. We'll see you later.
I lost my shoe in the park. It wasn't my fault. You've seen it. I love.